We touched it briefly last time also. The third is prophecies, and we talked about it also. And the sources from history, from science. If you look to this, you'll find the maps, vertical maps, manuscripts, archaeology, prophecies, and other sources. So you don't forget the 4 points. This is extra-biblical Christian sources. We talked about external, non-Christian. But now, we will talk about the quotations from early church fathers. From the early centuries, 1st century, 2nd century, 3rd century, the church fathers quoted from the Bible. So concerning the New Testament only, this is the quotations. Let me explain it for you. This man, his name is Justin the Martyr. He was martyred in 165 AD. And he quoted, he took verses from the Gospels, 200 in his writings, 268, 10 from the book of Acts, 43 from the epistles of St. Paul, 6 verses from the Catholic epistles, from 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, he took 6 verses, and 3 verses from the book of Revelation, so total is 330 quotations from the New Testament. Saint Irenaeus in the 2nd century. Who is Saint Irenaeus? Saint Irenaeus is a disciple of another saint. His name is Polycarp. And Polycarp is the disciple of John the Apostle, one of the disciples of our Lord Jesus. Our Lord had 12 disciples. One of them is John. The disciple of John is Polycarp. The disciple of Polycarp is Irenaeus. Irenaeus was in Lyon in France. He quoted 1,033 verses from the Gospels. And 194 from the book of Acts. 499, almost 500, from the epistles of St. Paul. 23 from the Catholic, 65 from the book of Revelation.
Is this how they came up with the actual text of the Bible?
No. The actual text is together. And they quoted the verses.
Just to make an extra book?
No. They did spiritual books, and they did quotations from the Bible, from the New Testament. Now, when I give a sermon, I see verses. When they wrote their books, they wrote verses. And scholars studying the writings of St. Justin, they make PhD. They study the writings of Saint Justin, and to take just the verses from Saint Justin, just as the verses from Saint Irenaeus, and so on, and to come with this table. Saint Clement of Alexandria, he wrote 3 books. And he was a philosopher in Alexandria. He is one of the deans of the school of Alexandria. His teacher is Pentinus. Pentinus is a dean of the school of Alexandria. Am I clear or it is confusing?
There's a number of quotation.
Yes, the verses from the New Testament only. Those saints wrote books. In their books, they did quotation from the New Testament. This is the number of quotations. Yes, then.
I was just being late. I wanted to understand what are these numbers. So these are quotations that basically verses from the gospel that they used in their books.
From the gospels, from Acts, from the letters of St. Paul, from the Catholicon, from the book of Revelation.
And they used that for any reason at all other than explanation?
Explanations, they talk about the spiritual stuff. And they made evidences from the verses of what our Lord Jesus said. And
so it was identical.
Yeah. Saint Clement of Alexandria, he wrote 3 books. He did quotations from the Gospels, 1,107 verses. This is what he took from the New Testament. Illustrations. And this from the book of Acts, this from Pauline, 1,127. And 207 from the Catholic epistles, and 11 verses from the book of Revelation. Look to this one. Origen. Origen of Alexandria. He was born. Actually, before to talk about Origen, Saint Clement of Alexandria, we have 2 Clement. Clement of Rome, Clement of Alexandria. Clement of Rome, his name is mentioned in the New Testament. In the Epistle to Philippians, chapter 4, verse 3. And this is Clement of Alexandria, Origen. Origen was born in Alexandria in 185 AD. While he was young, he read all the time. At age of 17, his father prepared himself. He put on the new clothes and wanted to go from the house to be a martyr, to confess our Lord Jesus Christ to the governor, and they will kill him because he is a Christian. Origen wants to go with his dad, but his mom hid his clothes. So they put his dad in prison. And Origen used to send letters to his dad, encouraging him to be steadfast in faith, not to deny Jesus, and not to worry about us. God will take care of us.
At what age?
17. And his dad died. Was killed. Because of his faith. And Origen, at the age of 18, became the principal of the school of Alexandria, the dean. The school of Alexandria at this time, it was Oxford or Harvard. It had 600,000 manuscripts. They go from different countries to Alexandria to study. And Origen, they call him Dean Teen. He was a teenager and he was the dean of the school of Alexandria. Saint Jerome, he said that Origen, I believe he wrote 3,000 books. And nobody can write 3,000 books. But he used it to dictating, to tell people and to write books. And he used it to do 7 books at one time. 7 different books. And he wrote the Bible in 6 translations. 6 in Greek is 5 in Greek is penta, pentagon. 6 is hexa, hexapela. His book is hexapela. He didn't do order from Amazon. He wrote it. He wrote it by himself. Hexapela.
By the way, last time we were talking about the four Gospels, so I...
Dietisron,
yeah, so
of Tatia.
Yeah, so I did a lot of research until I found one on Amazon. It's basically the four Gospels working next to each other. I ordered it. I don't know. I'm just going to get it and see how...
But show it to me.
I will bring it to you. I just want to...
I have... The Hexapela is lost, of course. But one of the Metropolitan Bishoy, before me, he said, if I find the Hexapela, I am willing to pay $1 million to get it.
Now, this one seems like a newly published.
Yeah,
thing.
But I have example of the Hexapela of origin, software, I have it. But I have some of his books. In my library, I have interpretation of Genesis, of Numbers, of Joshua, of Judges, Song of Songs, Ezekiel, Gospel of Matthew, the Gospel of St. John, and many other books by Origen. Look to his quotations.
So we're talking about the same Origen.
Yeah, we don't call him a saint, but the scholar, Origen the scholar. And I tell you this, he castrated himself because he used it to teach men and ladies, and he didn't want anything to prevent him from teaching anyone. So nobody will doubt him. The church didn't accept what he did, but he did it without asking. They call him Prince of the Interpreters of the Holy Bible, or they give him a title, the Teacher of the Bishops. And they say nowadays many people, they did the PhD in the writings of Origen. And they say that there is no a human mind can comprehend all what Origen wrote.
Why did the church not like his teaching?
Because he castrated himself. And they don't want anybody to do this. And the second, some accused him of some stuff wrong in the doctrine. In one book, It is called the principles. In Arabic, المبادئ. But in this principles, they say, no, no. This may be from dictation. And there is no person in the history of the church. The people didn't, they have many opinions about him other than Origen. Origen, the only person in the history of the church till now. Some people support and some people against. And the people who are against, at a certain time in the history of the church, they call them anti-Origen. So now, what I'm doing now, while I'm teaching you the Bible, I'm teaching you patristic, patrology, about the church fathers. Origen quoted, look to this, from the Gospels only, 9,000 verses, 231. This, after they burned many of his books, this is what remained. He quoted from the book of Acts, 349. He quoted from the epistles of St. Paul, 7,778. He quoted from the Catholicon epistles, 399. He quoted from Revelation 165. The scholar Origen. After him, the scholar also, Tertullian. In the second century. This is the first one from the church fathers to write in Latin language. He quoted 3,822 and so on. The next one is Hippolytus. Who is Hippolytus? He is in the third century. The first one to write a book about the interpretation of the book of Daniel, Hippolytus. Hippolytus, they call him father of tradition. He wrote about the tradition of the church. He wrote what? You know, he writes that the priest and the liturgy say, the Lord is with you. And the congregation to reply, and with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. And the congregation to say, it is with the Lord. And the priest to say, give thanks to God. And the congregation to say, meet and write. What I'm doing now? The liturgy.
Yes.
So he wrote about the liturgy, what they used to do. And he wrote this in 235. And they used it to say it before he wrote it. So to know how the liturgy is old.
So when did the liturgy actually start, do we know?
Yeah. From the covenant Thursday when our Lord Jesus gave his body and his blood to the disciples, and after the disciples received the Holy Spirit in Pentecost, and they used it together on Sunday for the Holy Communion, and they start from now on. Yeah.
But the actual words of the...
The actual word, what we have now from St. Mark, the Apostle, the liturgy of St. Cyril is the liturgy of St. Mark, but St. Cyril organized it, reordered it. You know, when I baptize a child, or anyone, how many times I baptize? How many times I immerse in the water? One baptism, but three immersion. Hippolytus said, the priest or the bishop, when he baptizes someone, should immerse him three times in the water. To ask him for the first time, do you believe in God the Father? And the one he is baptized say, I believe. I baptize you in the name of the Father. Do you believe in God the Son? And he says, I believe. I baptize you in the name of God the Son. Do you believe And God, the Holy Spirit, and he says, I believe, I baptize you in the name of the Holy Spirit. Why I'm asking you this? Because once I was teaching in the seminary, and someone asked me, when the church started to immerse the one who is baptized three times, if I don't know what Hippolytus said, and actually his book is surviving in Arabic language, and translated, of course. They call him what? Father of tradition. Origin, they call him Dean Teen. Clement of Alexandria, this is the philosopher. In one of his books, it is called Stromata. He mentioned 348 philosophers at his time. He read for them by name. 348. What about if you want to know the writings of this? It is free. It is software free. Anti-Nicene, Nicene, and post-Nicene fathers. What we are talking now, anti-Nicene, before the Council of Nicene. I have it. And anyone can have it, because it is free online, on the internet. Mm-hmm. And it has the PDF and the index. If you click on the index, Clement, you will find his three books. One of his books is Stromata. The other book is Instructor, Pedagogy. And the other writings. Hippolytus, Eusebius. Eusebius is a historian. He wrote ecclesiastical history, the history of the church, ecclesia of the church, the history of the church. Eusebius, we don't call him a saint also, because he believed the heresy of Arius. But we read his books because this is history. And this is the quotations. The total of these quotations only, we didn't say anything about Saint Cyprian, or Saint Athanasius, or Saint Augustine, or Saint Basil, or Saint Gregory, or Saint John Chrysostom, or Saint Alexander of Alexandria, or Saint Peter of Alexandria. We didn't say anything. We just took those only. And they said that the quotation is 36,289. This is the quotations from the New Testament. So they said, God forbid, if we lost the New Testament, we can rewrite it from these verses, if we lost it. Imagine if we didn't receive the New Testament, we could take it from the writings. All of New Testament can be recreated from early writings, except of 11 verses. In the seminary, I asked them about how many quotations do you think the fathers quoted from the New Testament before Nicaea? I don't want them to write. One of them actually, he wrote this accurately, 36,289. And one of the students, he wrote 15 quotations. Because I wanted to get idea, they know that how much the church fathers quoted from the New Testament. Yes.
One of the order we have here is that the order in years.
Chronology. Yeah.
Chronological order.
Yeah. We are talking about 165, late second century. This also 185. This his birth 185. So this is a dean of a school of Alexandria. This is the dean of the school of Alexandria, but after. And this is after him. This Hippolytus to 30. We are reaching to the fourth century. Comparing ancient manuscripts. Homer, Plato, Julius Caesar. This is the date of the writings. And this is, of course, the New Testament. This is the early copy. You see, Homer wrote, I want you to understand this, please. Homer wrote in what year? 800 BC. The first manuscript after him in the 400. So between the first manuscript and his writing, how many years?
400.
What I'm saying now, and when they say this is the book of Homer, did you find anybody to say, no, it is not the book of Homer? Did you see anyone to say this now? No. They question when they come to the New Testament. Why didn't they question Homer or Plato? This is the difference in years. But look to the New Testament. The gap between the manuscript and the writing of the apostles, just 50 years. Did you get it?
Mm-hmm.
And look to the numbers of copies. Homer 600, this Herodotus 8, Plato 7, Demosthenes 200. Look to the New Testament, 5,686 manuscripts. Why I'm saying this? Because sometimes some people doubt the Bible and they lead others to be atheists. They don't believe. But is this a proof? This is the whole books, these fragments, this most of the New Testament, this complete New Testament. The New Testament has more copies. The New Testament has more copies. Greek manuscripts of the New Testament. Papyri. This is in years. Sources in years. This is the letters of the manuscripts. And this is the totals. And this is published in the book of Bros in page 60 to 63. I know this introduction. And it is dry. Now to go to the types of the interpretation of the Holy Bible. Go to the types of the interpretation of the Holy Bible. Is this a kind of interpretation or commentary? They call it exegesis. Exegesis. I wanted to understand the Bible, then, there, them. Then, there, them. What had happened when our Lord fed the multitudes? How many people there? How many? There, then. And the second is hermeneutics. Hermeneutics, now, us,
here. After I understand them, I look to now. How I apply it. What is the benefit for me? Hermeneutics. The word hermeneutics, it is from Hermes. This is one of the gods of the Greeks responsible for interpretation. They took it for to be Christian. The word hermeneutic. Literal interpretation. The literal interpretation, it doesn't work too much with all the writings of the Bible. I give you example. If we wanted to interpret some books literally, so the literal meaning for the bride of the Song of Songs, the literal interpretation. So the bride will look like this.
Wow.
The hair is good. If you want to interpret it literally. And her neck is a tower. Mm-hmm. Or looks like this. Literal interpretation of the bride of the Song of Songs. Beautiful. Because her eyes like doves, her hair is like a flock of goats, her teeth are like a shorn sheep. And so, why I'm showing you this, that the literal interpretation, it doesn't work. So the school of Alexandria doesn't focus upon the literal interpretation. So, we don't focus upon literal interpretation. As St. Paul said in his epistle to Corinthians, chapter 2nd epistle, chapter 3, the letter kills, but the spirit gives life. And I will tell you a story about the letter kills. In the book of Judges, there was a war, a fight between Israel and the tribe of Ephraim. So the people, they wanted to know, they met together, all of them are Israel, but all the tribes of Israel against the tribe of Ephraim. Israel, Israelites against each other. So they wanted to know this man from the tribe of Ephraim or not. So they asked him to say the word Shepolt. And the tribe of Ephraim, they were Saida. They can't say Shepolt. So they say Sepolt. So they know that he is Ephraimites. So they kill him. They killed 42,000 from the word Shepolt. So St. Paul said, the letter kills, but the spirit gives life. Literal interpretation, historical interpretation. I know all the events of the Bible historically accurate, but we don't study them just for history because we don't study it as history. But we want to know the spiritual meaning. So, for example, our father Abraham, when he offered Isaac as a sacrifice, It really happened?
No.
It really happened that our father Abraham took Isaac to the mountain?
Yes.
Yes.
Really happened that he built altar?
Yes.
Yes.
He put the wood?
Yes.
He put Isaac?
Yes.
So historically is right. But it is a symbol of the sacrifice of the cross. Mm-hmm. When God, he sent his only begotten son. So we know the spiritual meaning. We know the spiritual meaning. So we go forth to the contextual. When we wanted to study the Bible, we wanted to take the whole context. We don't pick certain events. I will give you examples. Once I met a man and he was treating his wife not the right way. And I told him, why you do this with your wife? And he said, you know, the Bible says man is the head of woman. So he took this verse to use it against his wife, but he didn't take the whole Bible, the whole Holy Bible, to love his wife and to be kind and to help. And to... If you don't follow this, I give you another example. Someone I asked him, did you start fasting? And they said, no. Why you didn't start fasting yet? He said that the Bible says anything comes to the mouth doesn't defile man. Mm. But what? It comes from the mouth. I told him, but this verse, our Lord didn't say it regarding fasting. He said it when they asked him that the disciples ate without washing hands. So he take it out of context. So to take verses and not to take the whole verses, this it means that you pick some verses and pick and choose. The word heresy, it's a literal meaning in Greek, pick and choose. So when you pick and choose, this is a heresy. So we understand the whole Holy Bible in its context. We don't take just one event, one parable. Philology, interpretation, the language. The Holy Bible is written as narrative, stories, prophecies, poems, letters, different style. So I should know the grammar. Sometimes I give example with the Gospel of St. John chapter 8. The people of Israel, they told our Lord Jesus, we are children of Abraham. So our Lord told them, if you are children of Abraham, you should do what Abraham did. Your father Abraham desired to see me, and he saw me and rejoiced. They told our Lord, you are not 50 years old yet, and you saw Abraham. But consider this, that our Lord at this time, how old was he? But they thought that he is 50. You are not 50 years old, and you saw Abraham. And they told them, before Abraham, this is philology, Graham. No, before Abraham, I am.
I am, not I was.
Why? Because I am is the name of God. And when he said this, just I am, not I was, they wanted to stone him. They said that he made himself God.
Moses, the prophet, in the book of Exodus, chapter 3, when he asked God, when he appeared to him in the burning bush, what is your name? And he said, I am who I am. I am who I am. The word in Greek is ego in me. This is the name of God. Let me explain this for you. Our Lord in the Gospel of St. John, so I don't want to make the lecture dry. Mm-hmm. He said, seven great I am. In John chapter 6, he said, I am the bread of life. In John chapter 8, he said, I am the light of the world. In John chapter 10, he said, I am the good shepherd. And in the same chapter 10, he said, I am the door of the sheep. In chapter 11, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. In chapter 14, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And in chapter 15, he said, I am the true vine. So how many I am? This is, it fulfills all your needs. If you are hungry, our Lord is saying, I am the bread of life. Spiritual. If anyone lives in darkness, he says, I am the light of the world. If you need anybody to take care of you, he's saying, I'm the good shepherd. If you feel that everything is closed around you, he said, I'm the door of the sheep. If you feel that I'm dead spiritually, he tell you, I'm the resurrection and the life. If you feel injustice, he tells you, I'm the truth. If you feel that you are lost, he says, I'm the way. If you need supplies, he says, I'm the true vine and you are the branches and you receive the food from him and the support. So our Lord said, I am. This is in the Gospel of St. John. All of them. Because the Gospel of St. John is talking about the divinity of our Lord Jesus. And also, when we say this, nobody can say this except our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you remember I told you about a professor in Oxford? He was atheist. And when he read the gospel, he was a professor of ethics. He says, nobody can say this. I'm the resurrection, I'm the life, I'm the light of the world. So he read a lot to see the proof, and he became a Christian. And he wrote books in Christianity.
Who is it?
C.S. Lewis.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
And actually, he published the book of our patriarch, Saint Athanasius, on the incarnation of the Word. On the incarnation of the Word. So, philology. Same as grammatical. I know the grammar. I know the grammar. Etymology, the meanings of the words. The meanings of the words. Abraham, father of multitudes. Isaac means laughter. Sarah, princess. Moses took him from water. Bethel, house of God. And so on with the names Michael, who is like God, Michael, Gabriel, power of God, Raphael, God heals. So the meanings of the words, the meanings of the words. Literary, it means that the genre, it is written narrative, story, poem, letter. Let me give you this example. You know, when you want to write a letter in English, it has a structure. Right. You write the address, the date, dear Fulan, introduction, the body, sentence conclusion, sincerely, to sign. It has a structure. They used it to teach this in English. The letters of, in the Bible, it has six elements. At the time of the apostles, the letters, the epistles, should have six elements. The name of the sender, the recipients, he sent it to whom, the blessing, grace and peace with you, and the thanksgiving, I give thanks for this and this and this. Number five, the body. Number six, the conclusion. This is why you find St. Paul wrote how many epistles? 14. 13 of them, they start with the word of Paul, the name of the sender, to the Ephesians, to Romans, to Corinthians, the sender. The sender, the recipients, the blessing, grace and peace. But when he sent it to bishops, he had mercy. Grace and peace and mercy. So I find the mercy in three letters. First and second Timothy and Titus. Thanksgiving. He gives thanks for one of the three or the three together. Love, faith, hope. And the body, the theme of each epistle. And the conclusion. So this is literary. This literary, the style of writing. Allegorical, the interpretation allegory. The word allegory is mentioned in the Epistle to Galatians chapter 4. Allegory in English means symbolic. And the Bible sometimes interprets itself allegorically. And the second one is typology. I say this, I wanted to explain what is the difference between typology and allegory. Typology, two events, real events, I compare them to each other. When I compare Isaac to our Lord Jesus, or Joseph to our Lord Jesus, or Moses to our Lord Jesus. The allegory is this typology, two real events. The allegory, one real event was a spiritual one. One real event, one material was non-material. Sarah and Hagar, allegorical, Old Testament and the New Testament. Real event with something spiritual. Or let me say this, allegorical. The seed, you know the parable of the sower? The seed is the word of God. So the seed, something immaterial, the word of God, this is allegorical. So, allegorical typology. In early centuries, there were main schools, basics. The main schools, a school of Alexandria, a school of Antioch in Syria. Antioch focused upon the literal and the historical. The school of Alexandria focused upon allegory and the typology. Allegory start with a man, a Jewish, in the first century. His name is Philo. He interpreted the Pentateuch, the five books of Moses, allegorical. And continued with Origen and the others, and St. Augustine and many others, allegorical. They say that, you know, the Beanot? The shelf from outside is the literal. And the seed inside is the allegory on typology. So you take more benefits from the allegory. And Origen said, God, when he created the creatures, he created different foods. So the sheep eats different than the lion. And nobody tells the sheep, you eat grass. And nobody to tell the lion to eat meat. But from nature, they used to do this. So Origen said, even for human beings, they have different foods. You don't feed the babies like the adult. And you don't feed the sick people like the athletes. So he says that sometimes the Christians, when they are immature, you give them baby food. You give them milk, just to tell them a story. And to go in depth, and to talk about the deep stuff, is this solid food. If you say it to babies, it is like when you give a hamburger to a 4-month-old child. So he said that some people talk with him about Ruth, the story of Samuel. But to talk about the book of Numbers and the book of Leviticus, it needs maturity. So he says, if you are a child spiritual, ask God to give you maturity. And not to be superficial, but to go in depth. If you are sick, ask God for healing. So you have the desire for a solid food. This is in his sermon number 27 in the interpretation of the book of Numbers. So this is allegorical typology, numerology, interpretations of the numbers. They said, if there is a iota, letter iota, written in the Bible, it is for some benefits. If there is a dot, I give you example. What is the book in the Bible doesn't end with amen?
I'm an X.
X, why? Because it's still in the history of the church now. Continuation of the church is the continuation of the book of Acts. So when they write amen, it has a meaning. And when they don't write it, for a meaning. So if there is numbers written in the Bible, it has meanings. I give you example. When God created man,
6 days.
Friday. And when our Lord was crucified?
Friday.
Friday on the 6th day. To recreate man again.
Wow.
Same day. So, numbers. I tell you another example. The people whose names are mentioned before their birth, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, are 7. Perfect number. The people who God called them and repeated their names, Abraham, Abraham, Moses, Moses, Saul, Saul, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament are 7. Perfect number. When they chose deacons, how many deacons?
7.
The letters in the book of Revelation chapter 2 and 3, 7. How many trumpets?
Seven.
How many bowls?
Seven.
How many seals?
Seven.
How many archangels?
Seven.
How many feasts in the Old Testament in the book of Leviticus chapter 23, 24?
Seven.
How many prayers of Agbaya? How many sacraments of the church?
Seven.
How many statements our Lord said it on the cross?
Seven.
How many statements addressing Jesus on the cross?
Seven.
So good. Seven. Numerology. Tropological. Tropological means moral. How to have patience, to be gentle, to be humble. Tropological interpretation. Most of the sermons in the church, this kind. And the people are satisfied and happy. And but we should to talk about other kinds of interpretation. Angogical. What is angogical? Mystical, spiritual. I give you example of the mystical. The union between our Lord Jesus and the church. When I interpret it mystically, this is marriage, husband and wife. This is mystical. Eschatological. Eschata means last in Greek. Eschatological, the last things, the second coming, the age to come, the ends of the days. Now, let me give you example. We are done, but in 2 minutes. One word, I will interpret it different ways. The word Jerusalem, literally the city of Jerusalem. Allegorical, yourself. Mystical is the church. Eschatological, heaven, Jerusalem. So when you pray Psalm 50 in Agbaya, in the book of prayers, and to ask God, build the walls of Jerusalem, you are not talking literally. Because I don't care if the walls of Jerusalem were will be built or not. I don't care. I am not talking literally. I'm talking about myself, to the senses to be protected. So, sometimes one word and it has different meanings. And glory be to God forever. Amen. If you have any questions.
I always thought it was literal. But
I did the quiz, but not for the last slide. And if we don't have enough, I will bring more next time, God will. We have enough.